Thank you so much for having me here. It's really my pleasure, and I only have really fond memories of Grand Bahama. I was married here. I shot one of the better rounds of golf in my life here, and I'm a firm believer that Pisces has the best pizza in all of the Bahamas. So I was glad, and you know where I ate last night. So you've heard my background, and the fundamental question then becomes, why is a social worker from the States standing up here and trying to tell you how to fix the Bahamas and can give you information that you don't already know? And the reality is, I can't. I don't. The answers to and the concepts I'm going to talk about are ones that you'll be very familiar with. One of the fundamental issues that I think we'll talk through today and that drives us with the Organization of Responsible Governance as well as myself is the fundamental understanding that we all know that the car is broken. Everyone's got that. That's not the defining point. However, we tend to be pushing on the car in a little bit of a different direction. Some are pushing it this way, some are pushing that way. So our principle, our value, the focus and the hope through what we talk about today is that we line up behind the car, pick a direction, and all push together. And with that, we can move it a lot quicker than I think we are at this point. So today what I'm going to do, and Mersenth said I had a lot of time, so you're going to get the long version. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about what the organization is, how we came about, what we do. I'm also going to talk about some current initiatives. And then more importantly, we'll leave some time to talk about how we can all collaboratively work together. And if you have an interest in this or want to lend some thoughts and ideas, how we can maybe come up with a collective couple of steps of action that would drive us out of this room. My beginnings, I guess, let's start with what is the Organization for Responsible Governance? The Organization for Responsible Governance is a civil society organization. I'll talk through the specifics of it, but it started from a very similar place to where you're sitting. It started from Bahamian business folks. It came out of the group that worked on the VAT reform, that had an experience, a positive one at the end, that said that a private independent voice, one that was driven based on facts, that was driven on a more rational discussion, a collaborative discussion that engaged the public, was actually able to help government make a decision that was collectively better. And it wasn't to say that it was satisfying to everybody, that it was the right move at the right time, but when that push was put forward, people felt an ownership and a partnership to where that could go. When the VAT was pushed forward, if you'll recall, the consultants from New Zealand had recommended that here with this VAT, 15% with all kinds of exceptions doesn't necessarily make sense, but if you did it at 6.3 or 6.8 or what they settled at as 7.5 with very little exceptions, it'll achieve what you want. But before you do that, you should probably have a Freedom of Information Act so that there's a level of accountability. You should probably have a Fiscal Responsibility Act so that government is kept within certain limits and has certain requirements before they spend it in ways that maybe aren't what it was ultimately designed for. Based on timing and circumstance, that didn't happen. And so out of that effort, once VAT was pushed forward, there was a group of those business folks who had established their businesses well enough that they were doing well. They weren't those rising businessmen. They had done pretty well. However, what they were starting to see is that conditions in the Bahamas were deteriorating. The workforce was challenging to find the people that they needed. It was harder than ever to do business, more costly. And there was not a fair and level playing field. So they came together and they formed a volunteer effort called the Organization for Responsible Governance. So ORG is nonpartisan. I'll say that a couple of times today because people don't tend to believe us. You can't imagine the time and effort we spend to try and be neutral in our approach and specific to our comments and rational. And 2 days ago, we were accused of being the super PAC for the FNM. We are not. We are nonpartisan. We are consensus driven. So we work to draw in lots of perspectives and get people on board. We're not interested in developing another small group of folks who think they know the direction and follow us. We want people to be on board because we really do believe people, all the stakeholders have a value. We're Bahamian. Contrary to the executive director, everybody else is fully Bahamian. And my interest is I have a 9-year-old who grew up here in the Bahamas, loves it, and wants to live his whole life here. So we need to make sure there's something for him. We're future focused. So what we see is that the challenges we're experiencing very often, Mr. Thompson and I were talking a little about this, are that we have these 5-year cycles we tend to think about. And that change is driven or moved or plans are made or affected based on that 5-year cycle. Many of these issues that we're going to address that we talk about are going to be much longer standing, and we need consistency, and we need to talk about if it's going to be painful now, what would that lead us to, and how do we move forward, and how do we all have an ownership in that so that we understand what we need to do to get through that. We're not political. Everything is political, but we're not political. We don't endorse one party versus another, and the truth is our efforts do not predicate based on one party leader or one party or one group being in place. If our success as a nation is dependent upon one person or a small group of people to do what we think they need to do, we've cast our fate to the wind a little too much. So we need to believe that there can be policies, laws, levels of accountability that hold regardless of which administration holds power or which person gets in power. Because ultimately, the power needs to be and should be, in a democracy, in the hands of the people. So that's what we work for. We're not for profit. Our funding is very very clear. I'll tell you this: in the last year, we were able to get a very nice grant from the Templeton Religious Trust, which allowed us to do a lot of the research that we'll talk about, some of the community efforts, with the focus to say that their focus is on empowering individuals, and so they see this gap that the Bahamian people have gone through, where they've been systemically bashing their heads against a wall and believe that things aren't going to change and they can't control their own fate. So part of our efforts are really, how do we bring this conversation beyond this room, beyond this community, beyond this island, so that there is a collective rising of the Bahamian people's ability to articulate their interests and drive and help to provide a sustainable future. We also get funding from our core council. We have 7 individuals that contribute $1,000 a month or $1,000 worth of their marketing experience or accounting experience or product, whatever it might be, to help us through. I say that because if anybody here feels like they would like to support our efforts after everything I've said to say, please talk to me, because we got another year of work and another year of funding. But we are not for profit. We are driven based on the fact that we believe that a decision that more people sign off on is going to be a stronger decision, one that will hold longer. We're driven based on research and statistics. It's really critical for us to make sure that our information is fact-based. There's too much conjecture, there's too much confusion, there's too much out there for us to drive these major decisions based on hurt feelings, personality, ego, even suspicion or mistrust. You would have seen in a number of the big issues recently that the level of mistrust that exists in our country, it clouds our ability to make succinct and significant judgment about things that are very important. We based on research, matter of fact, just a quick point to that, research drives why we focus on this. Why would I be talking to you about governance? You are driven as an entity that puts and promotes the economy. Well, research has shown that good governance drives a more vibrant and positive economy. And you think about it in your relationship with your customers. If you're coming to them and you're opaque and you're not clear and they don't know how to get connected to your product and they don't know how to manage it and they don't feel that they've got that level of trust, well, then they're going to go somewhere else. And it clouds the processes. So good governance brings clarity. Clarity brings good business. That drives economies. And whether you look at developing countries or well-established countries, that research has now held out. And good governance is starting to be something that you see across the world in a majority of countries. More than 100 countries have signed on to something called the Open Government Partnership, which speaks about the fact that this needs to be a transparent and opaque process. We wouldn't do it just because we believe it. We would do it because it shows that, in fact, this is the path forward. We focus on public education and engagement. I'll talk more about that, but we really feel that, unfortunately, many of the conversations that drive our future as a country exclude large portions of the community, and for many reasons, and I think we can work on that. We work towards actionable and sustainable solutions, those long-term solutions, those ones that we can actually work on. There are a lot of great ideas. You have the most brilliant idea and five people around a table, and you can theoretically fix the world. But we need to put things in place that we can actually move on, because we have to look at the reality of our scenario and what can be movable and how we can move these parts. And part of that then drives why we want all people at the table, because we need to know what resources we have. We need to know who's at the table, what ideas, what thoughts. We have commissioned research that I'll talk about in a little bit coming from international sources. We have borrowed, like we did with the VAT, best practices that work in the world, or I'll talk about how we use that in freedom of information later. But more importantly, we brought it here, and we had Bahamian thinkers, Bahamian leaders, academia, media, businessmen, people in the over-the-hill communities that were sitting down and thinking about, does this work here? And if we're going to make it work here, what would we have to do to possibly change it? Or what could we maybe take of this and not put it there? Applying things to a Bahamian context is how things will move forward. To think that, well, they have this there, so we should be able to do it, is too simple, and it's not a way forward. It's a pipe dream. So we're based in this research focus on that good governance is the way. So let me just quickly go through what we mean towards good governance. And this is being more and more universally accepted across the world as the measure of good governance. There's a few things that would change, but this is what the model we. So I can't say consensus enough. Accountable. That governance should be a measure to say that those that are making decisions about the movement of a country, the use of its funds, the use of its resources, the legislative actions should be held accountable, and that there should be consequences in place when things don't go the way they are. That doesn't mean chop their heads off all the time, but it means recognizing that something is not working and taking measures to ensure that it does, and we need to fight for that. Responsive. That it meets the needs of what's going on in the general populace. Government is in place to serve the general public, and without a responsive mechanism, again, you have this isolation, this polarization that happens between the leadership and the populace. Transparent. We all want to know the rules of the game. It's simple, it's straightforward, it's how we live our lives. When we don't know, too often we assume the worst, or we make up our own rules, and that affects a number of things. It needs to be equitable and inclusive. Does it meet all the parts of our society? Does it reach and meet, or at least hear the needs of those groups? Is it fairly managed so that we see across the wide distribution? Everybody has the opportunity. You can't say that everybody's going to be equally successful, but does everybody have the opportunity to put in and make do with what they are? Do they have the chance to get the right information from government? Do they have a chance to participate? It's effective and efficient. And as from the private industry side, you would know this more than anyone, and this really comes from that sector. Is government resources being seen as a valuable and essential and limited base? And is it being used to the greatest return? Not just stats you can put up on a wall, but to the impact and the output of what the country needs. Follows the rule of law. Once this erodes at the top, it erodes at the bottom. And you see that. Why, if they're not being held accountable, why should we? If they can get away with it, why shouldn't we? And it they've shown again in research statistically that erosion of rule of law, that lack of good governance, it leads to increased crime. It leads to corruption. It leads to cronyism at all levels, and it affects not only what happens in terms of government institutions, but it affects the business community. Business practices then start to blend. It trickles down. And in order to run your business, you have to compromise your principles. You have to move away from what you said your standard practices are. And in some ways, you do it not based on any sort of evil trait, but because it's functional. We see recently there was a huge investment in road traffic in Nassau to make it more efficient and effective and move it to an electronic model, a digital model. And that means going away from folks flipping through pages and all kinds of stuff. So they made this investment, they changed things up, they set up this whole window system where you're supposed to move through and do different actions. And that would have prevented the long lines and the having to pay off the people to get through the system and move your vehicles through in the right way. However, if you go to road traffic now, although I think they've just changed it, what was interesting is right outside of every window, there was a cup. And every time you had an interaction with somebody, it said, oh, by the way, we are accepting tips. And it happened that blatantly. The reason it happened is because those people at road traffic had been depending upon having an income of their salary plus whatever else they get. Now that you've taken that away, well, look at that. You know, well, what are we going to do for our extra money? Right? How are we going to make our bills? How are we going to pay for electricity? And that's the trickle down. If you don't change it at core levels, if you don't ensure that the top is ensuring what they're doing and that you maintain that level of accountability, no matter what you come up with as a solution, it's going to erode or it's not going to achieve what you're trying to achieve. And then it's participatory. And this is where I think we're going to spend a lot of time in the next number of years. You see civil society starting to move in different ways. You see groups starting to change. The very honest stretch is that where you are as a chamber of commerce, as a business community, is in some ways where we aspire to be from civil society. You have structured mechanisms in place. You have people that, you have standard practices. You have operating systems that allow you to communicate across industry. And when you need to leverage your resources to move something or share information or work on an issue, you have a forum like this. Civil society is not there yet. And civil society represents a lot of the participation of individual citizens, communities. So we're working very quickly to make sure that group is part of this conversation, because for a long time, they have not necessarily been. What is our membership? We have, everybody is the answer, but we have clergy, artists, professionals, we have business, community, we have civil society, educators, unions, associations, even politicians. We have folks who come and support us and are part of our conversation, because we recognize that every one of these folks has a part of the solution. We can't create an educational opportunity, a new program, a thing that's going to turn things around if you haven't figured out how the Department of Education works and get some buy-in so that they will actually absorb the new ideas you have. So we know that we need all these people on board. And we see ourselves not as static, but very dynamic. So we want to keep growing these conversations we're having. We want to keep growing these forums we're a part of so that people will understand and be more receptive and be involved in what we're doing. And that is, if I'm giving you anything today, that's the instruction, is please carry forward what we know and think about who else needs to be a part of this. So our priority pillars, when org was initially founded, much like you've seen with these new initiatives from civil society like We March and some of these petitions, and they have 18 lists of things that need to happen. We need to do this, we need to do this, we need to do this, and none of them are wrong. We have to work on all of these things, immigration, energy policies, all these types of things. However, we thought, okay, how can we use our efforts most effectively? So we brought together last spring a group of about 30 civil society groups, a couple of private industry groups, but mostly civil society, and we said, let's give ourselves a day, let's sit down, let's talk about what would be the key priorities that we need to work on this long list. And out of that list of many, many items, we came up with three things. We came up with government accountability, we came up with better education, and we came up with economic development. And the reason we came up with these three, based on the input and the feedback and the ideas put forth on that day, were because these three all work in relationship to each other. So our system to say that if our country is going to have a positive future, we need a vibrant economy. We need to answer that question of how we start to move that GDP up and how we start to minimize that debt. We need to foster not only foreign direct investment projects, but local businesses. We need to make sure that we foster both. That's the mark of what our economy can be. However, you can't do so when you have a limited workforce. You can't do so when you're constantly having to bring folks in because we don't have the residual technical expertise or capacities. Our education system is drastically flawed at this stage, and we see that a large proportion, way over half of the students who are coming out of our schools are not prepared to compete in jobs that we're going to need if we're going to grow industries. Service-related jobs are one thing, but we need middle management. We need management. We need people that can come and start their businesses and be successful, and we need lots of them. So we have to figure out what's going on in the education system, and we need to make sure that it's linked up to providing vocational success. And then tertiarily, once those things are in place, you need accountability. You need a level playing field. You need to have a system where people can depend upon the rules and the laws that they're bound to, that they can have a say-so. And without any part of those three working together, you don't really move forward, right? You just have a straight line. So we need to work concurrently in all of those areas. And we took it on to say that we would start moving in these three areas. So this is somewhat repetitive, but what does government accountability mean? Obviously, it means reducing corruption. It means getting rid of cronyism. It shouldn't be based on who you know. That's your business model. Your business model shouldn't drive based on, I just have to affiliate with the guy who's in power and figure out how I can appease him. It should be based on that you should have mechanisms and say, this is my investment, this is my return on investment, these are the resources I need, and I can then make a much more long-term plan instead of how do I get through this month or this quarter. And it should limit government spending. That's a fundamental belief of ours. We feel like one of the biggest issues we see is monumental government spending without structure, without decision, without input. Not to say that there isn't decision or there might be information that's being used to make those decisions, but that's not widely held. And the byproduct of that, even if it's a good decision based on solid facts, is you see an erosion of public trust. And that erosion of public trust undermines the potential effectiveness of any long-term plans that might be made by any government or by any government official. So we see that. We see within education reform that it means a skilled workforce. We see that new opportunities, employment opportunities, need to happen. We see that there will be a decrease in criminal activity. There's lots of studies that show that direct correlation, that the better educated your populace is and the better opportunities they have for vocational success, there's a significant drop in crime. Clearly, that also links up with unemployment, right? And that's what unemployment economic development would mean to us. It means reducing our unemployment. How are we putting people to work? How are we using this incredible resource, this human capital that's available to us? We can tap into it. I was just telling the table earlier before that when I was part of Bahamar, I had this really wonderful opportunity to see something that worked. Bahamar obviously had this challenge. They wanted to bring in a new workforce. They didn't necessarily want to bring in the same unionized workforce that had been at other hotels. They were seeing a need to raise the level of service. So they kind of went to the apple tree, and they brought probably in total about 1,200 at-risk youth, many of whom had been on the wrong side of the law, many of whom were right on the verge, many who had struggled through school. And they brought them together and they said, if you can get through this 16-week boot camp kind of an opportunity, and we aren't even going to talk about hotel processes or hospitality, we're going to talk about leadership and articulation and presentation and conflict resolution. And they were up at 8, they were there till 4, they were marching, they were lifting things, they were doing activities, all of these things. And if 1,200 people came through, 1,000 graduated. And the thing that motivated them was that there was a real, meaningful, productive job that they believed in and were excited about at the end of it. So all of our efforts towards workforce development, when there's nowhere to go, well, Bahamian youth, they're smart, they're resilient. They spend their energy towards where they see a payoff. If there's no real payoff, it's hard to motivate yourself to be work ready when jobs aren't there. So we see that we need to come up with innovative ways. The challenge was that worked for that one new development because new jobs were coming on board. How many of those opportunities do we have? So it's hard to say that one scenario is something we could borrow, but there's in the root of that, you see the opportunity, and that's where we have to build on. We see we need opportunities for future generations. We're losing such a resource as our education system either sends the people who, the 30% who go through it well, are a large percentage of them are going and using it elsewhere. So we have to figure out how we bring that brain drain back, and we also have to figure out that 70% that potentially could be doing a lot more and be more engaged are valuable. And then the middle group that have the potential to move quickly, how are you engaging those? And that's going to require no government magic wand. It's going to require private industry. It's going to require folks like you coming up with ways that we can make this work. So this is just a quick visual that I think articulates kind of why we think org, because every organization, these are right. None of these ideas are things you don't know. Everybody's nodding because we've had these conversations. You've talked to them with your colleagues, with your family members, with your friends. So we know this. But why would we think that org is a different approach? So the main method is looking at where we were. So prior to this, you saw each group working relatively siloed in their own efforts, with their own resources, with their own ideas, with their own issues, and they were coming together, and each one was driving at government to try and move their issues. And what happens is you get very crowded, you box things out, you don't leverage what are the resources. And the end goal, still the ones we talk about, is we still want economic development, education reform, and government accountability. So our model that we look at, and forgive the hubris, but we see ourselves as the smartphone, as the Apple, right? And we see that all of these groups are these applications. All of them have a function. All of them have a purpose. All of them are usable. And we need to then create a button that helps us to work collectively on these issues. So that government, if you saw that, going back, you see, government is one of these issues, one of these items. They're not the gatekeepers. They are a mechanism that's necessary for us to get to sustainable solutions. So we see this leverage of how do we work collectively on these issues. And if we work on it through research, we're able to accomplish, we work through public education, we work through coordination and collaboration. These are our tools. We're able to accomplish our goals versus waiting for government to give us the go-ahead that we can make small gains on any one of these issues. So how do we work and leverage that experience? My background is in social work, but I had the benefit of going to a school that offered not just social work, sitting down and counseling with people, but worked specifically on things like community organizing, worked on administration of organizations. So in big pictures, and that's the strategy that we employ, is how do we understand, very much like you do with your businesses, how do we understand the skills of our employees? How do we understand the resources we have available? How do we understand the outside market and the opportunity? And how do we come up with a collective plan that moves our agendas forward? So that's what we've been working towards. That's how we've been working. And so in our efforts over the last year, and I left you a couple of sheets of paper on your chair so you can play along, but you would have seen that over the last year we've worked on a number of items. We've worked collectively, and our system of work is this. We feel like we want to first and foremost get information and get it right. So we want information that's based in fact. We look at local sources of information. We look at resources that are available. We get some research when needed. And then we bring that to a committee base. And we have three committees that follow each of those pillars. They're populated by volunteers that come from all different perspectives. We started these last fall. And we need to grow them. We've met probably four or five times. We've had some work going through what we've done, but we need to grow them further. I know Dan has been a part of one of our committee meetings. We've had some folks from some of the other islands call in. And we want to grow these so that they are reflective of not just a NASA-centric view, but that they are representative across the archipelago, because we need solutions that don't just work in the inner city that sits over there. So we bring people together with different ideas and different perspectives. And through that, we talk about actionable plans. We review those plans. We get their input, their say-so, their buy-in, their understanding, their commitment of doing XYZ, and then we move forward with those plans. Currently, our volunteers, our committees, our accountability has worked on freedom of information. We've had some initial discussions on fiscal responsibility. I'd like to talk to you a little bit about that. The accountability and the measure of holding the Public Disclosures Act, or either reforming it or being making sure it's followed. A State Sectors Act, which is really something we're looking at, that was instituted in New Zealand and other places, that looks at ensuring a very business-like mindset on the functions of public service. So are the departments of government accountable? How, with the monies they're using, are they making the sound decisions? Are they outsourcing, when necessary, functions that could be better done by the private sector? And if they're not, are they operating in a way that is not only fiscally sound, but more importantly, toward their end objective? When we hear stories about the Registrar General team not registering people because they don't have sleeves or because of what they're wearing and sending people away, well, that's endemic, that people are not realizing that their job is not just to have a 9-to-5 job and get a pension and be able to get anything that goes from it, but you're there to register people for an election. So whatever you do should be based on, how do I meet that outcome? When your best employees, when the folks that you imbue and trust with your businesses are asked to carry out the actions of your job, you want them conscious of what is the end goal. You're not just there to fill a hole, you're there to move us forward. And that's what a State Sectors Act is focused on. So we would be looking at something that would push that forward. A Whistleblowers Act. We need levels of accountability. We need to ensure that those people that feel that they have information or see something that's not going well are protected and incentivized to be able to move forward. That's a key part of accountability. And then most recently, we've put together a candidate questionnaire. One of the challenges we see with this election, and particularly given that it's been so quick, has been decisions and concepts are driven based on either a party affiliation that supersedes logic and or any information that comes forward, a necessity to think about how will this serve me personally in the short term, or as much as I think we really need an active and strong media, what I read in the newspaper yesterday. You know, it's not necessarily long term. It's what you just saw. So we put together a questionnaire that we disseminated to all of the candidates. I think we still have a few more to get out, that ask for their ideas, their thoughts, their vision on what they're going to do, on levels of accountability, on levels of education, on economic development, so that we can then make these publicly available so that people can make decisions. Now, we put this out. Our level of response might be as you would have expected. Those independent folks got back right away. You know, those smaller parties are a little hesitant to get there. The DNA was really happy to get out stuff. And then the other two parties in a limited fashion. And so what we see is that it needs to be a beginning. And it needs to be and morph into an ongoing evaluation system of how governments and government officials are doing their job. In the UK and other places, they've instituted something called a citizen's charter. And the citizen's charter is just, again, what you use in the business side to say, how are we doing? Those evaluations, those, you know, go online and fill out a survey, it's drawing it to make sure that this is a customer-based product, and how do we ensure that? So we see that moving in that direction and becoming, whatever results we get out of our questionnaire this time, the beginning of a conversation that leads to an ongoing piece that helps to actively present the voice of the citizenry. Freedom of information, which I know in the book was what I was going to talk all about, but I'm only going to talk a little bit about it because I think we have some other things we need to get to. Freedom of information, the basic concept of having access to information from the government and how the government decisions are made and how government resources are spent, is a crucial part of democracy. It can be called the cornerstone of democracy. We don't have it. You would have seen that in 2012, the prior administration, and it's important to be clear, without any public consultation, put forward a bill that was not seen to be very good. And in review, having seen it and looked through it, I would say it wasn't very good. It would have accomplished maybe some, but it wouldn't have really given us what we would want as a tool. So the current administration, to their credit, said, well, this is not sufficient, so we're going to take on this process, and they would move forward. They took, let's say, 2 years to put the first draft together, 2015. They released the draft. Only one or two organizations jumped on board. Citizens for Better Bahamas, Save the Bays, were right on front of trying to get people involved and aware of this. But there wasn't any process of real public consultation. It was just that the bill was put out there. Citizens for Better Bahamas came back with a list of significant recommendations. They employed some folks from Canada who do this on an ongoing basis to evaluate how it would stack up internationally. And they came back and saw that, in fact, it had good pieces in it, but it also had some things that were short of representing the interests of the people. It was much more favoring the protection of government, which is a balance that you see everywhere. We got on board and involved last year when they put together a public consultation schedule. And the only way that I got there was because they put it in one paper one day, and if you didn't see that paper on that day, you wouldn't have known that the meeting was going to happen in 2 days prior to that, past that. So we showed up, and there were five people. This was at the University of Bahamas, then the College of Bahamas auditorium. There were probably five people on the podium to present. They had Jeff Lloyd set up. They had a camera to record it. And we looked around the room, and of the groups that showed up, there was literally only 15 people in the room for all of NASA. This was to be the one meeting, all of NASA. What you would remember is they came to Grand Bahamas, and I think the people on the podium exceeded the people in the audience. So I think there were five on the podium and four in the audience. And similarly, they had marketed it through the newspaper, and that was it. Now, this had also come, obviously, right on the heels of the gender referendum and all of the monies and expenditures and all the energy around that. So it wasn't very well visible, and I don't think anybody was really as clear. The fundamental right to information, when you're dealing with people who are wondering, where's my next meal going to come? Why can't I leave my house because somebody's going to shoot me? What's going on with my kid who's not learning anything in school? Doesn't seem like the most pressing item if you don't make a big deal of it, if you don't press it. So we, 15 people that were there, decided we were going to look at getting our respective organizations together. And what we did is we put together a public forum for 11 different organizations. And we brought out at the dentist about 150 people, 120, 150, I don't know exact numbers. And it was an active discussion. We brought the commission from the government. They did their presentation. We had the folks from the Bar Association to give their perspective. We had civil society speak up. Citizens for Better Bahamas talked about their recommendations. And it started a conversation. Government continued on. They listened to our recommendation that they needed to have further meetings. They had some. Abaco got, I think, 30 folks, and maybe Exuma got 20 folks, but nothing to that level. So we took it upon ourselves as civil society organizations, private industry groups, because the chambers were part of that effort, to carry the message out, to get recommendations, to bring those together, and we gave them a consolidated list of 33 recommendations that would ensure that this would be a much more representative bill. Some of the key recommendations that we ended up following were that we felt that the information commissioner, the whole process is driven based on its oversight of an information commissioner that ensures that when you ask for information from government and they say no, that they've done so appropriate to the law. And so that person is critical across the world to making sure that this thing works. That position is still an appointed position, by recommendation of the Prime Minister, with consultation of the opposition leader, and the Governor General would appoint. So one of our recommendations was that should be more independent. There should either be an independent presence in that selection. You should come up with a short list that's then vetted publicly, and then it comes back. But something. There's many different, you know, a special parliamentary bipartisan commission, something that could be, make sure that this position is above reproach. Now, we all know there are a lot of people, regardless of party, who could do that job very well and would be dead fair. But why set up a system that doesn't reinforce that? So that was one. We wanted to make sure that there was clear guidelines as to what was included in national security. We wanted to make sure that things couldn't be sloughed off to say, this is we can't give you this information because of some very general determination that the minister would make to say that national security or the interests of the country would be compromised. We needed to make sure there was more definition. And it was along those lines that we really, again, pushed back on the side of the citizen. We gave our information into the commission. The commission came back. That commission said, thank you very much for the submissions. We will consider it. We will come out with our draft, which will go on to the Minister of Education. So we came out to jump forward to October or September, really, and we come to find out that the bill has been reviewed, the information has been put forward, and we asked for copies of what they came forward with so we could understand it. We were not allowed those copies. Well, we'll give it to you after it goes to cabinet. Well, once it's gone to cabinet, it's already set to go to parliament. So we started a greater discussion around public education. And we went to town halls, we met with organizations, and our 11 groups blossomed into 22 groups. And we pushed forward. And through the process, as they called for the bill to be tabled, we did more and more advocacy. We did letter writing. We did a petition, which I think gathered all in combo something like 9,000, 10,000 names that would represent people that wanted these recommendations to be taken forward. We went and we met with folks. We sent letters. We had people write emails all over. And when it was tabled, they ultimately went with the version they were given. There were no concessions to the things we had wanted. They included, I'm sorry, that's wrong. They included about 7 different items. They'll say 12, but it was about 7 different items that we had recommended. Some of them were important, but some of them were not the key ones. And we fought it all the way up to the passing in Parliament. We followed it to the Senate. We talked to senators. We did the same, and we moved forward. The bill was passed. It has not yet been enacted. So 5 years later, we come to a point where, wow, the same old thing happened. Now, as I told you, I'm not Bahamian, I'm not here, I'm the new guy. So every time I come up with a new idea, the most consistent thing I can tell you is everybody tells me why it's not gonna work. Why it's not gonna work, and particularly not here in the Bahamas, because this is the way things go in the Bahamas. So I will tell you, there's a long list of people that is that day when Parliament prorogued and they said, I told you they'd never pass it, but you're missing the point. The point is, on April, there were 15 people in a room in Nassau. And in December, and now, there are 22 different groups that represent over 100,000 people that now know what freedom of information is, are interested and supported and educated as to what it needs to happen. So part of our effort, part of what we need to do, is we need to change our own mindsets. We can't be in the mindset of it'll never happen. It'll never happen doesn't get us anywhere, and we still have to get up tomorrow and deal with this stuff. So we have to look at what are the gains, what are the fundamental foundational gains that need to accomplish. So that's the work that we've been doing over the last year. And freedom of information is one of a number of different items. One that I would love to have an ongoing relationship and discussion and action group around that comes from this chamber would be fiscal responsibility. We see the freedom of information as something in the next, we're gonna keep the efforts up, we're gonna keep pushing forward. We've already got 2 of the parties, if they win, to agree that they would enact it in their very first, as one of their first lines of agenda. So we feel like freedom of information will go forward. It's going to take about a year for it to pass. We will work on public education to make sure people know it, and we will continue to advocate for revision, because we know bills can be, laws can be revised. We need to see how these things go and push forward. We're not going to let that go. But fiscal responsibility was something that had been part of the chamber's discussions with the government for a long time, and they said, yeah, we'll move towards something like that. Well, in January, I don't know if anybody caught that, but Hal Kiedis talked about it and very quickly on a radio show said, yeah, we saw a report on fiscal responsibility, but we thought, you know what, it will limit our ability to spend money, particularly in times of natural disaster. Now, you all live with that more than any of us this year. But there are places and conditions where a Fiscal Responsibility Act can be modified or adapted to say it would do this. That shouldn't be a reason why you move forward on these other issues. So we see it as a crucial issue. We see it as necessary. The FNM, the DNA have both talked about the fact that they would put something like a fiscal responsibility in place. But when we ask to see what's the model you're looking at, what draft have you used, what language are you drawing from, we haven't yet gotten a response back. So we see this as, again, another thing that will have to be really pushed and driven by our independent groups. We see it as something, very honestly, that the business community, the holders, the drivers of our economy would need to push for even stronger than civil society. So we're committed and really interested in looking at how we can get a group that works together that comprises your chamber, the Bahamas Chamber, the Abaco Chamber, Long Island Association, any of the groups, the business groups, that provide a crux and push towards coming up with something that we feel works here, that provides our ability to, when we need to, and address things like hurricanes and other natural disasters, we can, and meets the needs of communities like yours, that when it needs to, we have to tap this stuff quickly. At the same point, we need to realize there has to be limits, there has to be provisions, and there has to be accountability if we're going to move forward. So that's going to be a big part of our next level of agenda. And we really look forward to hopefully bringing something strong out of that. And at the end of this, if I don't run out of all my time, I'd love to have some thoughts and your ideas about where we go in terms of next steps. Quickly through some of our other committees, education committee, we were thinking about new innovative ideas like charter schools called partnership schools, where we look at driving new innovative approaches in smaller settings that move away from some of the regulations. And we look at new and proper teacher evaluations. We look at things like socio-emotional curriculums, which teach kids not only just how to use the academics we're providing, but how do you apply it in your life? How do you make decisions? And we look at apprentice programs. Not just apprentice programs once people have gone through the education system, but if you see Switzerland, Singapore, you see in the States, in Colorado, in either Wisconsin or Montana, but one of those states, they're seeing secondary school apprenticeship programs that aren't driven based on, well, the smart kids go to the academics and the dumb kids go to the technical classes. No, they're incorporating it as learning opportunities throughout for secondary school. And you're seeing incredible gains. This is something that we, again, really are going to push forward to advocate because it can help us to get those kids on track for that vocational success that we're needing. And then our economic development. And we're talking about how we improve the GDP. We're talking about expanding a national portfolio. We're talking about how we improve the ease of doing business. And this is, again, a joint conversation and a joint project we've already started talking with the Bahamas Chamber about, and their conclave on the 15th and 16th is entirely topical around ease of doing business. Mersin, how much time do I have, just so I get? 5 minutes, great, okay. So I'm gonna shoot forward. One of the things we do is we work on citizen engagement and education, and we have a second website and a second effort called the Campaign for the Bahamas. We're trying to be kind of cool and say this is a campaign that everyone can believe in. And we do a lot of interactivity on that website. We've driven about 14,000 folks through that website, either taking quizzes or signing up or taking pledges, signing petitions, and we'll build on that. You may have seen a video we put out with Sawyer Boy recently that kind of is a way to make these issues relevant to folks in the communities. Freedom schools. One of the things we realized last year is we're bringing these great ideas, gender referendum, gender equality, we're talking about freedom of information, think about fiscal responsibility, relatively complex. To that person that is dealing with how do I deal with my day-to-day, how do I get through this week, next week, they haven't really been primed. When you look back at the civil rights effort in the US in the 60s, there were these entities called freedom schools that taught people the basics. So we need to teach our people how to, we need to teach them to vote and register to vote. We need to teach them to be a part of the next 5 years. How do you get the skills of advocating to your elected official? How do you tell them what your interests are? How do you make sure that they follow up? So we need to teach those skills. So this next year, we're going to be going into churches and town halls and community meetings and communities that you wouldn't necessarily think this to be, and have these smaller basic conversations to give people the understanding of what is the Constitution, how do we do the basic civics education. And I've left on, we also work on research, and I left on the table for each table a copy of our most recent research. I'm going to talk just a few minutes on that. We were able to get funding to get Oxford Economics to come down and look at how do we address this issue of economic growth. What are some of the ideas and the industries that we could facilitate that could move things forward? And we went to them thinking maybe they're going to say tech, maybe they're going to say aragonite development, maybe they're going to say, and what they came back to say, very honestly, is they said, look at the low-lying fruit. Look at what you already have in structure, but that could be moved forward. So you're not starting from scratch, but you're starting from you're in the mid-level game. They looked at manufacturing and agriculture, light manufacturing. They looked at logistics and shipping. And matter of fact, some of the folks in the room were part of that process. We came to Grand Bahamas. We talked to some of your folks, both about manufacturing and some of the shipping. And they looked at boutique tourism. And by boutique tourism, I'm talking about small-scale boutique hotels, but also the second home vacation rental market. And what they came back with were some recommendations and some strategies, ones that are reimagining things that we've done and looked at before, but with a little bit of a different standpoint. They brought in some qualitative, but they also brought in some quantitative measures that helped us say, with push forward, these things could manufacture into really not only discernible jobs, but not only direct economic benefit, but residual economic benefit. So I'm gonna, you each have a hard copy, but Maricent is going to send each of you an electronic copy, so that you'll get a chance to look through it and understand it. We see this as a conversation starter. What we want to do with this is we want to shop it around. We want to get your thoughts, your ideas, your perspectives about where we go next. The logistics section directly applies to Freeport and how we move forward in pushing things like a break bulk model. What are the things underpinning that needs to happen? So we need to also look at what are the fundamental things that need to work towards. What are the baby steps that we can move towards? Obviously, we've got to address energy. Obviously, we've got to talk about some workforce gaps. We've got to talk about some of our immigration policies. But if we keep it in vision of what we're trying to move forward, again, that car that's broken, we can all be lining up behind it and moving forward. So please do look at the research. Read through it. We'll be coming out with an education report probably next week or the beginning of the week following, similarly, that we would love your insight and thoughts on. And be a part of the collective decision, the collective process of making decisions, rather. We have a tagline to say, get informed and get involved. And that's what our call is to not only you, your employees, your colleagues who aren't here. We need to better understand the issues that are driving and affecting the Bahamas. And more importantly, we need to think about how we can work collectively to create these sustainable solutions. You can check us out. And in our scaling up, I talked a lot about what we'll work towards. But check us out on our website at orgbahamas.com is our main website, and the campaign for the campaign242.org is our engagement website. Think about them kind of about like the library and the bookmobile. The website, the campaign 242 is out there to try and get folks who maybe haven't even thought about this process a little bit engaged. And the org website has a lot more deep resources, a lot more involvement, and a lot more information. We need your voices as part of the conversation if we're really going to make change. And we remain very available to partner with you and very receptive to your input. Thank you for indulging me. I know I went long, but thank you so much.